Mpirical provide compelling, interactive learning across a range of delivery options. Live on-site, live online, or online anytime, we have a training course that is ideal for you. For a no-obligations chat about your training requirements, contact us at mpirical.com.
Beamforming is a key part of 5G new radio. So we're going to start by introducing beamforming, comparing it with spatial multiplexing, such that we can talk about how we create a beam and steer a beam, so that we can then move on and talk about the different types of MIMO antenna, and possibly you'll have heard the term single panel, multi-panel antennas, so we'll try and put our beams onto those types of antennas, so give you some examples at least. There are many examples to focus in on. So, first of all, we've got spatial multiplexing. We've had that for a long time. We've had beamforming for a long time in other systems, such as 4G. They are not mutually exclusive. So you can be doing beamforming, and you can then potentially put some spatial multiplexing onto that beam. What we need to discuss is how they relate to each other with respect to the sub-6 gigahertz band and the millimeter wave. So, to start with, in the sub-6 gigahertz band, if you start talking about MIMO typically you talk about MIMO orders, and we are currently up at sort of 8x8 MIMO is again a good talking point. And we start talking about having 8 layers going down to a device, and that's because of the spatial diversity that we have within the characteristics of the radio environment at those frequencies. As we start hitting the millimeter waves, however, we lose some of that spatial characteristics and we go towards a beam with less multipaths effectively. So the order of MIMO typically reduces within the beam. As such, the main techniques below 6 gigahertz, you start using more spatial multiplexing. Above the 6 gigahertz into the millimeter waves, very much beamforming to a single device. Why? Well, it's back to the channel characteristics. As I pointed out, sub-6 gigahertz, very rich in multipaths, ideally suited for spatial multiplexing. Millimeter wave, because of that direction of the beam, we're reducing the amount of multipaths, and therefore it's ideally suited for pure beamforming with the potential of possibly a little bit of spatial multiplexing in there as well. So looking at an example of how do we create a beam. So here I've got a single antenna element, and if we focus on this single antenna element, what you'll find is the energy that comes off that would typically go out in all directions, sort of in a 360 arc, potentially. What we're talking about is trying to get the beam to be narrow, and by adding more elements, so adding a second element here, it's going to have the effect of narrowing that beam, focusing the energy in a certain direction. How does it do that? Well, if we took a bird's eye view and looked at the radio waves propagating out from an antenna, what you'll find is, yes, they're going off in a certain direction. By adding a second antenna element, so here we have a second antenna element, what you can see, they are both now transmitting, and the key thing here is we reinforce the wave, if you like, in a certain direction. So in this direction, the main lobe goes off and there's more power. And it's a bit like dropping 2 stones into the water. The ripples coming off those 2 stones reinforce in a certain direction. However, as you keep on adding more and more antenna elements, yes, we get a stronger and stronger narrow beam in a certain direction, but we also start introducing side lobes. Okay, so we've introduced some side lobes. In this case, we've got 3 antenna elements, and as I go to 4 antenna elements, the main beam has got narrower, but also the side lobes have got less because more of that energy has gone into the main beam. And that's the key thing with a massive antenna array, massive MIMO. We're going to have lots of elements stacked against each other to focus the energy. But if we do that on the horizontal and the vertical plane, we can now get a 3-directional beam, like a laser pointer pointing in a certain direction. The key thing now is steering that beam, pointing it towards our target, our device. So by adding a phase change, and hence the term phased array, what we can do is effectively steer. So we can drop those 2 pebbles into the pond, yeah, with a slight time difference. So phase is more of a time difference, which will make the signal reinforce in a slightly different direction. So it's effectively going to point it in a certain direction. So yeah, by changing the phase of these antennas, by putting, for example, a 90 degree phase between each of these, it will have this impact. Now, a key part of changing the main beam, that's obviously great for the person or the device you're trying to connect to. Another key part here is the term null steering, the nulls. What are the nulls? Well, if you take that steered beam that we had previously, there are nulls. There are points where we're not transmitting. And those nulls are equally as important as the actual main beam. And you might say, well, why is that? And the best thing here is to give you an example. So I'm actually going off to an example from Keysight Technologies here. And as you can see, there's four devices here, four UEs. And I've got them all separated. So the first one here shows a UE being transmitted, a beam. The most important thing, however, isn't the fact that we're covering that particular user, or in the other cases, the other users. It's the fact that the other devices, whilst I'm communicating to you, they are in the null. So as you go to the second one and the third device, you can see that the red dots are actually in the blue areas, in the null areas of the beam that's being transmitted. And you can see for the third user and the fourth user, a similar approach. The key concept, however, is all of these four are transmitted at the same time. So effectively, we've got four beams going on to four different users. Whilst I'm reinforcing the energy in one direction for you, that signal is also generating nulls, and I'm trying to engineer those to point at the other users so I don't become interference for those users. And that's the key part of the antenna and the system design. As you steer a beam, however, be aware these nulls will move. So they're not rigid, and it's all because they're electronically controlled. And here I've got an example of steering a beam and just illustrating the fact that these nulls and the side lobes all change around. So when it comes to massive MIMO antennas, we're going to have effectively a big grid, an array. In this case, some of them are cross-polared in terms of their the polarization, so rather than being vertical or horizontal, cross-polar. And the idea is we might have the transmission and reception on different polarities, or we're doing some diversity, receiving on both polarities. The idea is as these radio multipaths bounce off objects potentially, the signal might get distorted, or even the device itself, as you move it in your hand, the actual polarization it requires will change. So we have these transmit, receive antennas. Now, in a normal, say, 4G LTE system, we would still have a cross-polar array in a similar way. But what we would typically find is all of these elements are all joined together. So they have what you call these subarrays. And for conventional, say, 4G systems, they may be all linked in there with one array. As we started adding fully dimensional MIMO into 4G systems, the subarrays started to get a bit smaller, and the key thing here is we started to add 3D MIMO, which was effectively the ability to tilt the beam up and down. As we go to massive MIMO, however, what we're talking about is each individual element is controlled, giving us more granularity in terms of how we focus those beams and point it, the beams and the nulls effectively in the right direction. If you look at an antenna design, though, I've given you a quick picture there. It can be very complex, and it is very complex in terms of that antenna design for these massive MIMO systems. And sometimes it doesn't look like just a piece of metal. It sometimes looks like a little panel in its own right, or a little RF design board, effectively. Now, you can also use this array, if you like, this grid, for lower sub 6 gigahertz bands. And what I've tried to illustrate here is as you increase the frequency, the key concept is the wavelength will reduce, the spacing and the size of the antenna elements will also reduce. Now, here's an example from one of the vendors. It's worth pointing out that every vendor will have a certain set of options and roadmaps, but typically they'll start talking about their support of massive MIMO, the amount of ports they support, potentially how that can evolve or how they are evolving, or different capabilities potentially says, yes, I can support maybe 256 ports or 512 ports. So you'll hear, you know, the fact that these 5G new radio base stations and antenna systems are, again, becoming better and better and better. What about the devices? Well, yeah, the device will also need some RF modules supporting the millimeter wave, the beamforming concept. So it's worth pointing out, on most devices where you might have had one RF module historically, because of the nature of the beamforming and the fact that the hand can get in the way, so in this example, this device has, say, four modules, you can see one of them is actually being covered up. So the idea, depending on how you hold the phone, depends on, you know, the radio propagation that you're going to get from that device. And because of that, 5G supports the ability, A, to use different radio modules, but also the ability to switch. So getting the device to say, right, I know you're using this one, but think about transmitting, or can you please try and transmit on this other antenna port? I'll take a measurement and I'll tell you which ones are the best. So you might find you can do various reports to do with antenna switching. Finally, I mentioned the term multi-panel antenna. So here we have a multi-panel antenna. So rather than just have one panel, in this case, I've got four panels, more elements. And we can use that as an advantage. And that might be because we are steering multiple beams towards one device. In addition, we could use it in the multi-MIMO environment to steer beams to different devices. Now, I will point out different vendors have different solutions, and not consistent is the word panels, multi-panels, and the use of those. Again, it's back to the finer details of the design. But ultimately, you have the ability in the standards to support single panel, multi-panel operation. So we've focused on how do we create a beam, how do you steer a beam, and also introduce the concept of null beams and null steering. We've identified that we have massive MIMO antennas, an array, and that array effectively enables you to pinpoint beams in certain directions. We've also identified that the handset, we have some issues with the RF modules as well. And finally, we just introduced that concept of single panel, multi-panel antennas and how they may be utilized in different ways.
Need to know more? Why not visit our store, where you can choose from over 200 hours of video-based training? Alternatively, you can contact us to discuss any specific training requirements you may have.